This knot is the trigger point and has profound disrupting effects on the physiology of the muscle fascicle. Formation of the knot compresses the arterioles of the affected fiber and restricts blood flow, which is one of the main causes of trigger point formation at the level of the sarcomere. The reduced blood flow diminishes energy production in the hypercontracted fiber, and since ATP is necessary for both the contraction and relaxation phases of the cycle, once the ATP has been consumed by the contraction phase, the contracted sarcomeres cannot return to their relaxed state. Let us take a closer look at the start of trigger point formation to better understand how trigger points form and why they cause pain. Let us look inside the fiber at the sarcomeres to see how they respond to the constant release of acetylcholine by the dysfunctional endplate. Here are a few of the key structures inside a fiber. The fiber is the cell of the muscle, so we are looking at the structures and their organization inside a muscle cell. Of note are the long myofibrils that are comprised of sarcomeres, which contain the contractile elements of actin and myosin. Filling the inside of the fiber is a fluid-like cytoplasm called sarcoplasm, which is not shown. Also scattered around between the myofibrils are mitochondria that synthesize ATP, which serves as the chemical energy to power muscle contraction and relaxation. We have already discussed the role of the sarcoplasmic reticulum to store calcium, and the T-tubules that transmit the electrical impulse from the outer fiber membrane into the fiber and over the surface of the sarcoplasmic reticulum to cause calcium release and initiate contraction. A myofibril will be magnified to better observe the effect of miniature endplate potentials on the sarcomeres during trigger point formation. Although miniature endplate potentials are inadequate to stimulate a full fiber contraction, they are nonetheless able to spread over the fiber membrane and into the T-tubule system and cause release of small amounts of calcium from the sarcoplasmic reticulum. The released calcium is sufficient to activate the actin-myosin crosslinking and produce contractions by just those sarcomeres under the active endplate. Sarcomeres cannot alter their volume, and shortening during contraction causes them to widen. As the sarcomeres contract and widen, the arterioles that carry glucose and oxygen to the fiber become compressed. Sarcomeres require ATP for both contraction and relaxation. Adenosine triphosphate, or ATP, is the main form in which energy is transferred and stored within cells. ATP is synthesized by mitochondria as part of the oxidative metabolism of glucose. The terminal phosphate bond of ATP is a high-energy bond that can release its energy to drive cellular processes. Normal cells are replete with ATP. Here we see the contraction-relaxation cycle of actin and myosin, and the critical role for ATP in this cycle. During the contraction-relaxation cycle, the myosin head is either bound to ATP or to actin. Myosin is bound to ATP in preparation for cross-linking and only releases ATP as it binds to actin. Likewise, myosin remains bound to actin until it can again bind ATP. Only then does it release from actin. During hypercontraction, blood flow is restricted by the swelling sarcomeres, and the increasing ischemia suppresses ATP synthesis. Decreasing fiber ATP prevents bound myosin head units from releasing actin, and the sarcomere is held in a progressively contracting state. As the sarcomere reaches its maximum contraction during trigger point formation, it is being continuously stimulated to contract by the constant barrage of miniature endplate potentials causing calcium release. This causes the sarcomere to become hypercontracted. As the first sarcomeres shorten, they draw adjoining sarcomeres under the endplate that also initiate contraction. Increased energy demand at the same time as metabolic supply is impaired results in a localized energy crisis. Without further ATP synthesis, myosin cannot release from its actin crosslink. The calcium pump is also sensitive to low ATP and cannot return calcium to storage in the sarcoplasmic reticulum so that the contractile mechanisms continue to be stimulated. Other hypercontracted sarcomeres accumulate into the knot under the dysfunctional end plate. The stressed sarcomeres are also damaged and the fiber releases cellular contents into the fascicle. Local ischemia, combined with the release by damaged fibers of inflammatory chemicals such as bradykinin, substance P, and histamine, stimulates the fascicle nociceptors to generate pain signals. We will now look at the relationships between muscle trigger points and pain.